Hi, welcome to the Australian School of Business video series on leadership. In this series, we're interviewing adjunct professors, senior business leaders in Australia and internationally who are actively involved in the Australian School of Business's teaching program and mentoring our students. Today, my colleague, Senior Deputy Dean Greg Whitwell, is interviewing Mark Scott, Managing Director of the ABC. Mark received an AO from the Australian Government for his services to media, and he's been a member of the Executive Committee of the Australian School of Business Advisory Council since 2008. Please join me in watching and learning from Mark Scott as he talks about his life of leadership, his lessons of leadership, and how he's managed to be one of the most effective media leaders in Australia.
Mark, welcome to the Australian School of Business. Thanks for being part of this series of interviews on leadership. The ABC may be widely used, highly popular, highly trusted, but it also has its fair share of critics, noisy complainants. And indeed, in recent days, and not for the last or for the first time, you've had to defend the ABC for its actions. Yeah. What are the challenges of being the head of an organisation of which nearly everyone has an opinion about what it should or shouldn't do?
I mean, one of the first things you've got to come to get your head around is the fact that that's the reality. Everybody owns the ABC. Everyone's a shareholder. I mean, I sometimes joke that, you know, Christmas lunch at my family's place is a shareholder meeting of the ABC, and everybody has forthright views about what they've liked and what they don't like. And I think you've firstly got to accept that you're part of the public fabric and institution, and so you need to respect that people have their views. I think it's an organisation that generates passions. Mm-hmm. I think the supporters are very passionate, but the critics can be passionate as well. And what it's very important to do, I think, is to actively engage with those criticisms where you hear them. But it's important you don't get into this knee-jerk defensiveness that says you defend and you defend and you defend. At times, if you get it wrong, it's very important to admit to that, mm-hmm. be upfront with that, and concede that. It was one of the things I learnt through newspapers, actually. Mm-hmm. No newspaper runs more corrections than the New York Times, and no newspaper is more respected for the way it takes accuracy seriously than the New York Times. And the fact that you're willing to correct shows that you take the truth seriously. So I think you've got to engage, but at times you've got to get out there and robustly defend the organisation against critics who are ill-founded. And I think some of our critics are ideologically driven, and some of our critics are commercially driven. They want the ABC to be a lesser organisation so they can make more money for their shareholders. And my argument on that is they can look after their shareholders, I'll look after ours, and our shareholders are the Australian people, and you've got to keep them pretty forefront in your mind.
Margaret Simon said of you in a 2011 article that Mark Scott has become one of the most influential people in Australian media, arguably the most influential. What's the basis of your influence, and is it solely to do with being the head of such an important cultural institution?
Yeah, look, I suppose a couple of things. I sometimes think those comments are often overstated, but the reality is, of course, there's a certain amount of influence that comes on just sitting in the chair on the job on day one. Mm-hmm. The ABC has such a big reach, has played such an important role in Australian life. There are some things that come with the job. I think, though, what's been significant in recent years is that we are an industry in massive transformation. The business models in which media companies were so powerful and so influential have collapsed. Mm-hmm. And even at the ABC, even though our funding comes from government, we've had to run a pretty substantive change program from being a great old-style radio and television broadcaster to being a public broadcaster of the digital era. There's this irony. There's a line from The Leopard that I like, which says, if you want things to stay the way they are, everything will have to change. And so we've got a lot of very passionate staff at the ABC. They love it. They want it to remain as significant as it has been in the past. But part of what we've had to deal with the staff and explain to them is if we really want to preserve our place, we're really going to have to change. And I've enjoyed getting out and talking with people externally, but also spending a lot of time internally about making the case for change, making sure that people understand the direction we're going, that people sign up for that, and that people become champions of change.
Mark, let's return to something that you were talking about before, the issue of experimentation, innovation. And you said in a recent speech that one of the advantages that secure taxpayer funding provides for the ABC is the freedom to experiment, to take risks and innovate without the need to demonstrate a financial return. But it's also true that even with that secure taxpayer funding, the ABC may not innovate. Yeah. But it seems that under you it has. And again, to quote from your own website, the ABC has established a reputation as Australia's leading digital media innovator during the time that you've been CEO. So how, as a leader, do you foster an environment in which innovation is encouraged, change is accepted, and risks are willingly taken?
I think one of the things we've done really is leverage off the passion of our people for content and connecting with audiences. You know, you've got made a great program. You want that to find as big an audience as you can. And I think we just now know in this era, audience want to experience content at a time they want, on a device they want, in a format that they want. And so I think we use the passion for the content that says, well, how do we connect? I think a great example of this is Triple J. At Triple J, they just love their music and they love Triple J. But the reach of Triple J, the number of people experiencing Triple J each week, has about doubled in the last 5 years. And that has been because Triple J is not just a radio station. It's a website, it's an app, it's a social media phenomena, it's a partner with new services like Spotify and RDO, and it has taken advantage of every opportunity and every possible outlet to find audiences and to drag them into the Triple J experience. And so why did they do that? Why weren't they defensive that we're radio and we just want to be radio? Because they wanted to be where the audience is. And so that's what I think we've really done. We've leveraged off the passion to connect with audiences, and we've gone to try and find that audience wherever it is, and that has forced us in a path of innovation.
Tell me about the early days at the ABC. I'm interested in particular, how did you go about determining what would be your immediate priorities?
Well, I think I learned a bit on the job here. I'd signed a five-year contract, and I'd read the books on the first 90 days, and I thought, right, I've really got to work out where the five-year plan is. And one of the things that fascinated me about media was, particularly in this era, was how quickly it was all changing. You know, when I started in 2006, Facebook had only just opened up beyond the US college market. Well, now, you know, 7+ years later, 1 billion users around the world, extraordinary transformations in this time. And so I quickly realised that any plan I set for 5 years down the track was going to just fall wide of the mark. But what you could get a sense of was that the future's that away, you know, and that's where we're going over those hills. And I did have a sense that if you were moving at some speed and some momentum, rather than being paralysed and waiting for it all to become clear, it would be easier to tack, to change lanes, to adjust your direction once more knowledge became clear. And so quite early on, I think my messages were to work out what were those broad directions we'd need to be heading in, consult with staff, consult with stakeholders, give a directional sense, and then start making moves in that direction by setting up key projects or endorsing some strategies that moved us there, and then keeping the staff pretty informed around all that.
Mark, I'd like to know something about your management style. How would you describe it? But tell me something also about how do you deal with the pressures of being a CEO? How do you manage your time? And what kind of support structure do you have?
Well, I've got a family that keeps me very grounded. You know, three daughters in their late teens, early 20s. They cop no nonsense and they keep me very grounded. And my wife, Bryony, she's very important too. She's principal of a big girls' school here in Sydney. And, you know, one of the things that we often talk about and learn is that really all the key issues I find are people issues. You know, when I quietly close the door and have a quiet moment and I beat my head against the table, it's always people issues. Yeah. And it's one of the things I think I've learned. Look, you can have a great brand, but you can trash that brand. You can have a technological innovation, but others will get it. The thing that's really going to make a difference for you is the people. Can you attract the right people? Can you keep the right people? Can you identify the talent who will deliver for you? And I think that goes to my management style. I'm not a micromanager. I said at my very first executive meeting around that table, I said, if I'd applied for a number of your jobs, I wouldn't have got them. You know, because they had deep specialist understanding in their operational areas, but I felt I could lead the team and bring them together. And that is to provide clarity around the direction that we're going, a sense of goals and outcomes that we need to achieve together, a clarification of the values and the standards and how we were to interact with each other. That would be very important too. I think I would hope that the staff at the ABC would say that I think it's fair to say some of them say they don't see too much of me. It's a big organisation, but I hope they'd feel connected with me, that they hear from me, that I listen to them, that I engage with them, that I'm really quite approachable, and I don't project as though I have all the answers, but I'm in the market for smart questions and smart answers from our team.
Mark, you've been wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thanks.